It's Morbin time.
Everyone, I'm Matt, aka Legion Rex, and welcome to another amazing episode of The Gap. I'm your Morbin host, Matt, aka Legion Rex. With me, I have my co-host Shane, aka the Bearded One. Is it Morbin time?
Shinji-kun, I'm Morbin! And his head blows up. That's my favorite scene in the movie.
With me, I have my co-host Spencer. How are you doing today, Spencer?
Frankly, Scarlet, I'm Morbin.
I don't give a morb.
I don't give a morb.
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a morb.
Did you guys see how much money that like fucking Morbius came back to the theaters?
$84
a theater.
$82 per theater average.
That's just 82 more bucks.
$82 a theater in over 1,000 theaters. It barely made on its first day $85,000. It got beat by fucking Fantastic Beasts, which is in like 300 to 400 less theaters than it.
Listen, okay, you could
it's
say...
It's so funny. It's so funny.
You could say that bringing it back to theaters was a pointless endeavor, but I'm saying that that's just another 82 more bucks to add to the cause, baby. One step closer to 1 trillion tickets.
1 trillion tickets sold. I do think it's hilarious on how the internet collectively gaslighted Sony into re-releasing this thing to waste money. I think it's hilarious, frankly.
I mean, Sony can fucking cop out a few bucks, you know what I'm saying?
They're gonna make their money back when they inevitably re-release Spider-Verse 5. They'll be fine. But in any case, we have a wonderful show planned for y'all today. We have some simulcast to talk about, some simulpubs, as well as quite a bit of news. There was quite a bit of bigger pieces of news that dropped this past 2 weeks. So we'll have a bunch to talk about there. And of course, our featured anime of the podcast, which is Mushishi, a show I've been meaning to talk about for quite a while because I'm a big fan of it. So let's just jump right into it with some simulcasts. We're almost at the end of the season. Next podcast will be our end of season awards, as per usual with these sort of things, because most of the shows have only two to three episodes left, if that. So this is basically your guys' last chance to talk about if we have anything to add on the shows that are currently airing. Shane, is there anything, any shows in the past couple weeks that have really caught your eye you want to talk about?
I don't have any shows in particular that I want to discuss. I just wanted to say, as a whole, I think this season's been pretty damn good.
This is really good season.
Even just for the high profile stuff like Spy Family, but also a lot of lesser known titles, a lot of lesser known shows flying under a lot of people's radars that, hey, are actually pretty damn cool.
Is this maybe one of the best seasons in a while for smaller stuff?
This is the Black Horse season, in my eyes. A lot of those shows that people would probably read the synopsis on Mal and be like, that sounds pretty dumb, I'm not gonna watch this, turns out they're pretty fucking good.
Birdie Wayne is the one that I mentioned there.
Tweet, 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 tweet.
Birdie Wayne is so good. It's so good right now. There's no reason for it to be as good as it is. Just an incredible, peak fiction. It is becoming peak fiction.
Peak fiction, I think, is incredible. For all of the best ways.
Exactly, it's not even a joke. It's legitimately good shit. It's well directed, well written, got great characters. It's wonderfully ridiculous, but at the same time, it's also so sincere. I love how it's literally about a golf death game because it's being run by the mafia and the main character has a debt to pay to the mafia and has to defeat her fucking lesbian rival.
Golf lesbians. Can't believe I said
golf
that,
lesbians, but... can't go wrong. Can't go wrong with it.
Can't go wrong.
Golf needs more lesbians.
Yeah. Also, there's robo arms.
Mm-hmm. There's robo arms that use like soup that can influence your superpowers, but then you get.
Then they call out their golf strikes like attacks. Like, it's like, fucking great.
Like a shonen attack.
Yeah, like it's move yeah, over or some shit.
Move over, Dark Tournament. This is the next best shonen tournament arc.
Fucking, this season's really solid so far, honestly. Like, what? Like, it's, and it's crazy to me on how both summer and fall are just packed with tons of shows. Mm-hmm. So like, are we looking at like a really, we're like looking at like a damn good year.
Is 2022 like the 2018 of anime?
Yeah, I remember when we first, like the first year we ever fully covered, but yeah, and it's just like, that year was nuts. And I'm hoping it's like that again. It seems like it's like that.
Come on, dude. With all the shit that's going on in fall, like, come on.
Yeah. Spencer, any show in particular you want to talk about as we come up near the end of the season?
I mean, yeah, a couple. So, A Stab Life finished today.
It's finished. Is it only 10? Because it's
12.
It started early.
That makes sense. Okay, I didn't know it did.
It started real early. A Stab Life is done, and I'm very sad, because it was just goofy. It was just fun, goofy. It does not deserve what it has on fucking Mal, and I think Mother's Basement pointed that out in his video.
Once again, like, based Jeff Thu coming in hot.
Based Jeff Thu coming in hot with my shared opinions.
With the correct take.
Like, oh, okay, so the CG isn't Studio Orange levels, but, you know, Polygon Pictures still does pretty solid CG, and the whole thing is CG. There's no fucking gross 2D models that show up out of nowhere. Like, this does not deserve close to the same score that fucking X-Arm got.
No, it absolutely does not. Just from the animation I've seen, it looks... From the animation I've seen, it looks fine. Like, it doesn't look...
Yeah,
it's serviceable. Totally, it's totally don't worry about it. Don't, like, stop worrying about it, peeps. Like, yeah. CG anime is not the end of everything. Like,
it's not... It's good. I enjoyed it. Obviously, Birdie Wing. Kaguya-sama, I'm caught up on that, and every season of Kaguya-sama, as I've stated before, just gets better and better.
Yep.
So, this is better than the second season, which was better than the first season. All three seasons are incredible, but
one of the show just... One of those rare shows that just keeps outdoing itself.
Yeah, like Golden Kamuy was the same way.
Yeah. And, oh, when season four comes around, baby.
Oh, baby. And I'm also caught up on Executioner and her way of life.
I don't know if
Shane's caught up on it.
I'm definitely not caught up.
Oh my god, it's so good.
Okay,
like, fucking...
then I can't even fucking talk about the newest episode.
Yeah, because it's just every episode, it's one of those shows where every episode you just keeps on adding to, like, the fucking, like, plot and the twists and stuff, and you just, like, hope, like, when will it end? Like,
Dwarf just Central.
Nutty shit.
It is nutty shit.
Oh, and I love it, I think it's great.
This is the best fantasy / isekai of, like, fucking a decade.
This is the isekai to beat this year. I think
it really is.
This is the easy, unless the sword isekai somehow fucking delivers, which apparently it's very good. The light novel's based on is very good, which is why a lot of people are looking forward to it. But, at right now, this is the isekai to beat. And
yeah.
I love what they're doing with it. And it's shocking that JC staff decided that this is the show they're not going to fucking crumble on, apparently.
Yeah, no, episode 10 and it's still holding strong. It's still solid.
Yeah, and it's hopefully gets a second season because it deserves it.
That's honestly just commendable. Like, good job, JC.
Is it based on light novels or is it
it's a light novel thing.
Light novel, okay, makes sense. Yeah. But genuinely, yeah, good job, JC. You nailed it on this one. The story is incredible, the character, the world building, like like this show comes around once a generation and just flops its massive isekai dick on the table, and you can't help but admire it and go, huh, that's a nice isekai dick.
Yeah, easily most underrated of the season too, because it has like a 6.95 on Mal. What?
Are you shitting me? 8, 9.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I definitely deserves like a high 7 of the least. Like it's the least. Very good. I really like it a lot, and I think there's a lot of stuff going for it. The two shows I want to mention are just like a one of which is just an update and to tell people to continue watch this show because I want to. I don't think I've done enough with this. Said that enough of this show this past season, which is Healer Girl. If you haven't watched Healer Girl yet, please do that. Its most recent episode is the best it's had in the show so far.
Oh, okay.
And because it has a full ass Sound of Music style musical number, and it's fucking phenomenal.
Incredible.
And it's gorgeously animated. This is what happens when you get Studio 3Hz doing an original, because one of the only studios today still doing like putting out high quality level original stuff. And this is another example of that. I don't know if this is like as good as something like Flip Flappers, but then again, what is?
Flip Flappers also had like a different.
Yeah, I had a completely different team too. Yeah,
I was even gonna say just a series of genres. Healer Girl is first and foremost a musical. Like first and foremost, Flip Flappers was fucking weird.
That's what it was. Dragon Ball Z with magical.
Flip Flappers was the best kind of weird.
Yeah,
lesbian Dragon very Ball. Weird.
Lesbian Dragon Ball Mad Max.
Yeah, pretty much. And the other show I want to talk about is, I don't know if I mentioned it on the podcast yet, actually, because I want to talk about it a little bit more. If you have, because I am fully caught up on A Couple of Cuckoos. And A Couple of Cuckoos is 100% is probably going to be end up as like my favorite trashy show of the year. Because it's one of those shows that has like a really like convoluted, stupid premise, but like it's animated so well and the characters are so likable that I don't care. If you haven't seen it, the base synopsis is the only thing I'm gonna give you is is basically guy and girl switched at birth. And then parents decide when they're older to put them in arranged marriage, so the entire both families can be together. That is the basic premise of this. And of course, they don't like each other because drama. Mm-hmm. But if you haven't seen it yet, go check it out. There's a sequence I think in like episode 2 or 3 that's like a sequence involving water.
Yeah, I've seen that one. I've seen that on Twitter.
It's like such so good, fantastic. Lots of great. It's one of those shows where I just put Sakuga in for no reason, and it's like, which is the best kind of show.
Best
I love
kind
shows
of show,
that
yeah.
do that. I love shows that just have the show doesn't need Sakuga, but there's Sakuga there, and it looks so good. But yeah, those are the only two shows I really want to bring up because I just want to get more people to watch them because I like those two shows quite a bit. I think that's not a lot else. I don't think we're simulcast because we're pretty much near the end of the season. So let's move on to Simulpubs, also known as the One Piece Corner.
As the One Piece discussion.
Again. You read the new chapter today because
read
we're recording
chapter,
late.
Yep.
We are recording a little bit late. We're recording on Sunday, so the chapter has come out by the time we recorded this.
Wano's done, dude.
Wano, yeah, I think we'll have like one or two chapters actually left. To just wrap everything up.
Wrap everything up. Make sure that Luffy and Zoro are alive.
Oh yeah, Zoro still is fighting the Grim Reaper. I'm
still
pretty sure.
To this day.
He's still fighting the Grim Reaper.
Kaido's in the fucking ground. Wano has been liberated, but Zoro's still fighting that Reaper, dude.
Mononosuke is fucking an adult now, and I love him. I love his new design.
The design is so good.
So good. But I think most importantly, Yamato is joining the Straw Hats.
We knew this day would come.
No, but were we ready for this day to come? Because
well, it's here. So
well, it's it, well. Okay, were you ready for it, Shane?
Maybe not like immediately as soon as Kaido was down, but I'm not complaining.
It's very fitting, though. That's the Yamato is the Odin to Luffy's Roger. Mm-hmm. So it makes complete sense. And once again, we start to see the parallels between Luffy and Roger. If you just, it's all making sense, all adding up. And now we're entering post-Wano, which means the really good shit is about to come. We're about to find out what happened in the Reverie very soon. It's just in time for Film Red, too, if you notice this.
Almost like
it was planned, Shane. I can't believe
Shanks is dead.
If
Shanks dies off screen, I'm going to write Oda a very mean letter.
If I don't see Shanks become a fucking snake, I'm gonna lose it. Cause we like all know what's gonna happen.
Shanks is evil. I'm dying.
And
because Wano is over, I officially have to take the L, and L is not here.
Thank you for admitting that you were wrong.
It is an L. I know. I was digging my grave last podcast about it.
I don't know what fucking glue you were huffing, dude.
I'm pretty sure it was just like a bunch of like tinfoil hat theories that I fucking came up because of a bunch of iconography that I recognized. I guess I just read into fucking One Piece too much. I think that's probably what it is. But now it's post-Wano. Now I can save bad opinions and bad theories for like another arc.
Post-Wano, and it turns out Enel was the one who killed Sabo at the Reverie.
If that actually what happens, I will live on camera eat my socks. I think honestly what probably happened to Sabo, I think Sabo just probably got captured. I think Sabo probably got captured.
But what about
the Wano though? What's going to be the next arc is the question, because we had been building the Wano since Punk Hazard, and
it's literally been a decade in the making.
It's really been a decade in the making. This is a super important moment for the series. But so I don't know where they go from here, because to an extent, yeah, we have one more Poneglyph left, and it's with Shanks. So technically, you would think that's Shanks' next goal. However, One Piece has a tendency to go in unexpected directions, and there's still some stuff that needs to happen. That we need to go to specifically Elbaf.
That's what I was thinking too.
That is the, like, the Elbaf constantly throws me off, because I'm wondering to myself, when are we going to do Elbaf? Because it's in the New World. It's before Laugh Tale, and it's a place. If we go there, it's going to be the culmination of Usopp's arc. It's Usopp's big
finally becoming a warrior of the sea.
Yeah, finally becoming a warrior of the sea, similar to how, and also I realized this, with the stuff in Wano, this the only thing we have left to really solve is not just the stuff with Zoro possibly dying from the Grim Reaper, but also Zoro's heritage, because they still haven't really answered that question, because that was brought up.
It was brought up in Clap. Yeah, before it got clapped. By death.
Pretty much, it was brought up right before. And it's so... Who is he connected to? Because it's clearly somebody important, and they gotta answer that. Unless they're saving that for post-Wano, which is very likely. Or they're just not gonna answer it at all, and fucking... I don't know. They're gonna talk about it, though. Because he's... it's important. Like, he's connected to somebody.
Man, when it comes to the Zoro heritage stuff, like, all my mind goes to is Ryuma. Like, that's, that's, come on, like...
Yeah, because we never, because what the reason why I'm so stuck on it is because he's the only Straw Hat we don't know, like, outside of Brook, but Brook is a different case. That we don't know his parents or where he came from.
We don't, honestly, with Brook, we don't need to know exactly where he came from. We already
dead, technically, so yeah. Like
we already got his backstory with Laboon and everything, so that's more than enough.
Yeah, like the most we got for Zoro was like, yo, he was living at a sword training place.
He just showed up to that dojo, man. He just
showed up to a dojo one day, which when you piece it together, it's very clear that something's missing there. There's like a piece of his backstory entirely missing. So I'm hoping that gets resolved by the end of this arc. All right. Anything else people want to talk about manga wise that they've been reading or no?
Oh, I just went and got a sparkling water while you guys were talking about One Piece. So, you know,
that's fair.
Fair, yeah.
You guys are just saying words at this point. Like, what the fuck is an Elbaf?
Elbaf.
Elbaf. You know, remember the fucking giant people from Little Garden?
That was years ago.
It's the Island of Giants. That's all you need to
know. It's the Island of Giants. They are important.
and Usopp wants to go there.
Yeah, because they told he wants to go there because the giants told him that he would fit in there and shit.
Mm-hmm. I see. Okay, next question. Can zone users just turn it off?
Yeah.
So
you remember the fucking guy from what's his name from Drum Island, the first guy we see with the zone.
I know exactly who you're talking about.
Moose Man. Was it fucking Elkman?
So Chopper can just become a fucking reindeer.
That's one of his forms, yes.
It's just like an anatomically correct reindeer?
Yeah.
Cool.
He just has other forms too.
Duncan!
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, Duncan. He can turn into like a.
No, it's not an elk. He turns into a cow.
Oh, yeah,
turns into a bison. That's it.
Yeah, he turns into a bison, yeah. And then he can transform back into a person.
There are no blind spots on a cube.
Draft man,
yeah.
Do you think Kaku's coming back at some point?
No.
Do you think... Probably
not. The only two CP9 people who've come back are Spandam and fucking
Lucci.
Rob Lucci, the rest of them are probably not coming back because clearly they're not important enough to come back. And even then, Rob Lucci is the only one who seems to be there building up to that he's probably going to have a role again. Spandam is just there because, you know, annoying.
Hate that.
I don't like Spandam. I've never liked Spandam.
Hate that man. Should get hit by a truck.
Okay. So next question. Where is Law in all this?
He's in Wano.
We thought he got fucked for a bit, but he's fine. He defeated Big Mom.
Yeah, he and Kid teamed up on Big Mom.
With the help of Kid. Him and Kid teamed up to beat Kid to beat Big Mom. So
Eustace Kid.
Yeah, I'm thinking Eustace is going to join up with the Straw Hat fleet. Honestly,
I want Law and Kid's crews to become part of the alliance.
I think they will. Law at this point clearly has a friendship with Luffy. Like, it's very clear that even if he'll deny it, he has a friendship with the Straw Hat crew at this point. He's not going to go anywhere, and also he's too popular of a character. Meanwhile, Kid got a lot of focus this arc, in Wano, and is kind of being built up as, like, Luffy's, like, kind of, like, more, like, a friendlier rival to Luffy.
Yeah, rival character. Yeah.
kind of like a rival character to Luffy. So like I'm thinking he's going to join the fleet. He's gonna be
a metal hand. Right?
No, I guess I'll join the alliance. So
yeah, he's got a metal hand.
Metal fruit.
His fruit is basically he's Magneto.
He's got the power of magnetism. But instead of doing it like Magneto, he just makes a big arm and go punch.
And also he makes a big mech. And in Wano, he makes a big mech and he grabs Kaido when he's in dragon form. And then he yells out Slam Gibson, which is a move, and he just slams Kaido into the ground, and it's pretty cool.
Okay. So basically he's Unga Bunga.
You know,
extremely Unga.
You know what I think is insane, Matt?
What?
Now that Wano is like officially wrapped up, like we are done, I find it incredibly hilarious that both Kaido and Big Mom are just chilling out underneath Wano in a big pool of lava.
Look, at least they won't be alone. You know, that's the one. That's the beauty of One Piece. At the very least, even its villains, you know, you have sympathy even for its villains, except for Spandam. Fuck that bitch.
Fuck that guy.
And Akainu as well. Especially fuck that guy.
He's the guy who kills Ace, right?
Yep.
Yeah. Fuck that guy. Lava Man.
Oh, that guy. That wasn't the guy I was thinking of.
Fuck that guy.
I was thinking of Borsellino.
I actually really like Teach, so.
Yeah.
Marshall D. Teach.
Yeah.
Teach is like one of those assholes, but like he's also kind of like a funny asshole. He's too likable. He's too likable to hate. That's the problem with Teach.
The person I was thinking of was Borsellino. He's a fucking Yakuza looking motherfucker. Kizaru.
Kizaru.
Oh, that guy is kind of a sociopath.
I mean, that's fine.
Maybe the most busted bell fruit in the entire series, possibly.
Yeah, probably.
He's a man made of light, Spencer.
Oh, that's busted.
And like, it's a Logia, right? So he can just be. Hello,
he's made of light. He's a light man. He's made of the properties of light. He cannot be hurt. He can move at any speed he wants. He's like uber powerful as well. So
yeah, Aokiji, continuing to be the best admiral, even though he's not an admiral anymore.
Yeah, he's not an admiral. I love Aokiji. Aokiji is literally like he's just an ice dude. He's just the boy.
He rides a bicycle across the ocean.
It's made of ice, bro.
Okay.
Like he rides his bicycle across the ocean and he just freezes a path so he can ride.
Also, Punk Hazard is half ice, half fire because Ace and Aokiji fought there once.
Really?
Yeah, their fight was so powerful that it literally turned the island inhabitable and half of it fire, half of it ice.
And then
it's a big ass island. This ain't not a small ass island. This is like fucking like a Prince Edward Island size island. It's pretty fucking big, actually.
And then Fujitora has like gravity powers.
Yeah.
Fujitora is actually kind of a G. I like Fujitora.
I love him. Great guy.
Alright, we talked about One Piece enough. We're talking about we're not turning this into a One Piece podcast again.
We can.
I mean, we could, but at the same time, we got other stuff to talk about. Any other manga we got to talk about from this past 2 weeks, or no?
I haven't read the name of My Hero chapter.
Are people caught up on Kaisen? Because I still...
No.
I want to talk about Kaisen. Then y'all are caught up.
Next podcast, I'll be caught up.
Shane, are you caught up on Kaisen?
No.
Get caught up on Kaisen.
I will.
Yes, and I have read the new My Hero chapters.
I have not read. Yeah. I haven't read the one that came out today, but I read last week's.
Judo!
I read all of them.
Judo!
Judo!
Let's go! I'm so happy she's in the and Tokoyami as well. So yeah.
My boy, my bird boy.
Fucking it's hype shit. I have read the new chapter. I won't go too much into it for Shane's sake, but it is. It is very good. It's very, very
hell, good. You know what? Fuck it. I'm going to pull Spencer. I'm just going to read the chapter.
Are you going to read it on live on podcast?
Just read it on live.
Read it on live podcast.
Show's great. Show whips.
Yeah. But as a Geodo fan, this chapter admittedly also was very painful for me as a Geodo is best girl camp, and as someone who's in Geodo is best girl camp, this was not a fun chapter to read.
No, she is best girl.
Mm-hmm.
All of them are, but
yes, Spencer.
Yeah, all of them.
That saved me. I was like,
thank you. It took me a second to go. Even I don't
believe
that. I was going to
say, because I know for a fact Jiro's not your favorite girl.
No, it's Haraka.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. Okay. I'm not saying it's a bad, very, a very respectable choice, but I did not expect it to be her.
Who did you think it was? Kami?
Mm-hmm. Thought it was Kami.
I mean, Kami's not Kami, here.
It hasn't been Kami in, like...
But I haven't seen her in forever, yeah, so...
She's
of
got...
the ones that...
Did Horikoshi forget about her?
We say that, and then Horikoshi brings stuff up. I finished Vigilantes. It rules.
Okay, yeah, oh, how was the ending of it?
Incredible.
Ah, that's good to know. I've been reading the Vita for a while. Maybe I'll actually read it now.
There is
done.
No fucking way that they'll be able to tie it in, though.
Oh,
no
so
fucking
it,
way.
There's an end. It has an ending that's like they can't do it. And
the main character is currently on the run from the Japanese police and lives in the U.S.
Huh? Oh wait, lives in the U.S. Oh, so they have escaped somewhere where they could fucking just do what they're doing legally as a cop.
And it's also funny because it really goes to show how fucking you can be the hero, but because you're not licensed, everybody thinks you're some evil man, because that's what they charged him with, was vigilantism. Property damage and vigilantism, and they were going to haul him off the jail for it. It's like, and he's like, nah, I'm going to go work in the U.S. now, bye.
Okay, then. Okay, how many chapters is it? Because, like...
It's like 130?
Yeah,
around
something.
There?
Let me... I'm on the Viz website. It is 100 and...
Oh, Christ, no.
Yeah, Shane, you got to it?
126, map.
126. Oh, that's not that bad. Although our chapter's longer than the usual, like 20.
Nope.
Because isn't it like monthly?
It was bi-weekly, I think.
It was bi-weekly.
Oh, so okay.
Peppers aren't that long. They're
but also
20
she doesn't
pages.
Have an ear.
Yeah, she's in mono now. She's not in stereo anymore.
This fucking sucks.
Oh, I heard it, Matt. I heard it. You didn't repeat it.
Yeah, no.
I heard it.
Just sandbagged.
Yep.
But, yeah, it's painful, right? She lost an ear. Horikoshi's brutal, man. Horikoshi just doesn't give a fuck about you and, like, doesn't give a fuck about his character's safety at all. He's like, yeah, no, anyone could die at any moment. Who gives a shit? Fuck you.
That's honestly refreshing. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
No, I do. And, dude, and you know what? And the fact that she lost an ear and is still there, fucking trooper. Absolute fucking trooper. But yeah, pain, it's pain. That's what it is. I think we're done talking about manga now, actually. Mm-hmm. I don't think there's anything else, unless anyone else has anything else to bring up.
Nope.
Alright, we're good to go then? Are we good to go for news then? Or is Shane still...
You remember Zipman, Shane?
God, don't remind me of Zipman, dude.
Dude, I constantly think about it, and it makes me...
Yeah, poor Zip Man. But in any case, let's move on to the...
Oh, yeah, baby.
Did you get to it?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, the fucking vibranium.
Fuck him up, Hawks.
Yeah.
Anyway,
the, like,
okay.
Vibranium sword.
I read the chapter.
Thing? Yeah.
Chapter's dope.
Good chapter.
Yeah, good chapter.
Shit whips. Good soup.
Oh, yeah, but let's move on to our featured anime. No, not featured anime. Fucking news. It's stupid. Let's talk about some news. So our first piece of news comes courtesy of Troika. If you don't know who Troika is the people behind shows like Recreators. And Bloom Into You. They have a new show coming out. So let's read on. Troika and DMM Pictures debuted the teaser promotional video and first key visual for their new original series, Shinobi no Itoki, or Itoki the Ninja, on Sunday. The teaser announces the story premise, main cast, main staff, and the October premiere for the anime. So yet another show in the fall. The ninja battle anime depicts the heart fate of Itoki Sakabuta, a seemingly ordinary boy who learns that one day he is the 19th legitimate heir of the Iga Ninja and the long-growing war between the Iga and the Koga Ninja. Shu Watanabe, who worked on key animation for Aldenor Zero, Recreators, ID Invaded, and Idolish 7, will be directing it in his directorial debut. Minato Takano, who worked on the live-action adaptations of Kakiguri and Keep Your Hands Off of Aizuken, which I've heard is very good, will be writing. Isamu Suzuki, who worked on character designs and animation direction for Bloom Into You, Idolish 7, and Recreators, will be designing characters for this and also be chief animation director on this. And Tomashita, who did the music for Macross Delta, is composing music. Both Troika and DMM Pictures are credited with original planning for the series, and Troika is animating. I'm very excited for this because of the staff in particular. Strong fucking staff involved on this. Troika does good work. They don't do work all the time. They're very they only really seem to do work every once in a while, but they are very high quality. Since both of you have seen ID Invaded, I'm shocked y'all haven't seen Recreators yet because it's from the same team as that show.
Oh, it is. Wow. Recreators has been on the list for years.
Mm-hmm. Oh, based on an original work.
Huh. Yeah,
it's basically a reverse isekai.
Yeah.
I've heard and I'm excited.
It's a reverse isekai that also is both an awesome like battle royale between different type. It's different kind of stare. Like they literally different characters from different kinds of anime and manga and light novels come. You have a two fantasy protagonists come in, a magical girl character comes in, a mecha lead comes in, there's like a gangster from like a gangster drama like Bakano, there's a character who is like from a mobile game, I believe, in there. There's a a fucking visual novel Otome lead is in the series at one point, so it's got like a bunch of different stuff there. It's wonderfully animated.
Isn't there also a character that's basically just Saber?
That's the lead. I think that's like one of the lead two fantasy protagonists, I'm pretty sure.
Her name is Alter.
Alter, I think. Yeah. It's been a while since I've seen it. I really loved Recreators though. If you haven't seen it, highly recommend it. This is another original from Troika, and Troika tends to do really good originals, so definitely keep an eye on this one. The teaser also looked really impressive because it has really strong animation on it, and I'm really excited for it.
It's October.
Because it's one of those trailers where like the part, like what's really impressive about it is the particle effects are very good.
I love shows like that.
Mm-hmm. So it looks very impressive to me. Speaking of particle effects, let's talk about Speed Racer for a second. Entertainment news websites Variety and The Hollywood Reporter reported on Wednesday that the Speed Racer anime is getting a new live action series at Apple by J.J. Abrams. According to sources, Hiram Martinez, who is the showrunner on Snowpiercer, is serving as showrunner and co-runner of the series with Ron Fitzgerald, who is one of the showrunners on Westworld. Abrams is serving executive producer at his company Bad Robot. The website states the live-action series is part of Abrams' and Bad Robot's deal with Warner Brothers TV, and has been in the works for several years. This is not the first time that Speed Racer has been adapted into live action. In 2008, the Wachowski sisters adapted Speed Racer back into live action. And if the first thing you got to know about me and Shane is that we love that movie.
That movie is fucking incredible, dude.
We love that movie. That movie is fan fucking tastic. And my go-to proof that you can do anime in live action and do it well.
Just gotta get the right people, man.
Yeah, if you haven't seen the live-action Speed Racer, please do it. Please. John Goodman's in it, so you know it's worth watching. And watch it on the biggest screen you can with like fucking 4K resolution.
Surround sound. Fucking
yeah, because that movie's an absolute visceral feast. It's like one of the most visually kinetic films I've ever seen. That being said, will this work? I don't know. Apple, admittedly, has been really impressing recently with their original stuff on their platform. They have Severance, which is very good. They have Foundation, which is really good. And they just won an Oscar for Coda. So clearly they know what they're doing. So I'm curious. So they'll have the money for it. That's for sure. It's Apple. Whether or not it'll actually be good is another factor. They have the Westworld people involved, which is... But other than that, we'll keep an eye on this. If this actually happens, because live action anime tends to be a 50-50 chance of it actually getting off the pre-production stage. So let's move on to one of the bigger announcements of the past couple weeks, which is more news about Josh's favorite thing, which unfortunately he's not here, so he can't talk about it. Let's talk about Konosuba. Because Kadokawa announced on Saturday that the previously announced new anime for the Konosubas, It's God's Blessing on This Wonderful World franchise, is a third season of the anime. Kadokawa also announced that the Konosuba and Explosion on This Wonderful World spin-off light novel series is getting a television anime adaptation. Anime scriptwriter Makoto Izo, anime character designer Koichi Kituka, and director Takumi Kanasaki created illustrations to commemorate the announcement. Previous anime director Takumi Kanasaki has been upgraded to chief director now, where he will be directing both series. He will be the chief director on both series, which will be at Studio Drive. This is the third studio to do Konosuba. After Studio Dean did the first two seasons and JC Stab did the movie, Yujiro Abe will be taking over as main director. He was previously an episode director on episodes, listen to this, Great Pretender and Kaguya-sama.
Both of those are good.
I'm checking here which episodes in particular. He did episode 19 for Great Pretender. For Kaguya-sama, he was the episode director on episodes 1 and 7 of the first season and 3 and 12 of season 2.
Ooh.
So really solid ass director. Mikoto Izu is once again returning to direct and write, and Koichi Kituka is returning as character designer. So it's the same staff as the prior two entries, which just proves that studio is irrelevant. Like, who gives a shit? It's staff that's important.
Who fucking cares anymore?
Yeah. The same staff for the third season will also produce the Konosuba and Explosion of the Wonderful World television anime series. And the spinoff will have Rie Takahashi return as Megumin, as well as a new character named Yunayun, who will be voiced by Aki Toyosaki, who I personally recognize as the voice of Charlotte from Berserk. So that's specifically the Golden Age arc films. And she is the voice of Izuzu Soma from Fruits Basket.
Oh.
She's in a lot. Okay, I'm just looking at She's Aoi from Eurocamp as well. So, okay, she's in that too. She's in a lot, actually. Okay, she's everywhere. So in any case, she will be in that. I'm excited for this. Shane still hasn't seen Konosuba and should. If you have not seen Konosuba, what are you doing? Go watch it. It's one of the better isekais out there. I think Spencer has seen it. I think.
Yes.
Are you both seasons, one season?
Both seasons. Everything? Both seasons.
All right.
I haven't seen the movie yet.
Mm-hmm. Even though the Pulp Fiction writer considers it cinema.
Cinema.
Yeah.
Kino.
Kino.
Kino, indeed. But yeah, I'm excited for this, and we'll keep an eye on it. It's probably not going to come out till next year, though.
No, definitely.
Speaking of stuff that was recently announced, Star Wars Celebration happened the past week. I wouldn't care to talk about it on this podcast because it's not anime, but they did talk about Star Wars Visions, so I will mention it.
We can never escape it.
Talk about Star Wars Visions, aka fucking Kino. If you haven't watched Star Wars Visions, what do you do? It's episodes are like 10 minutes. You can just binge it in a day. It's like,
yeah.
But Lucasfilm announced at Star Wars Celebration Anaheim 2022 that on Sunday, the Star Wars Vision project will have a volume 2 sometime next year. The staff verbally said they plan to release the volume in spring of 2023. So it's around basically the spring season of next year. The announcement video teased at creators from United States, specifically California, Chile, United Kingdom, Ireland, France, Spain, South Africa, India, South Korea, and Japan are involved in this season. So it is not just anime, not just Japanese anime. I'm most excited for the idea of a South Korean Star Wars thing, because that sounds rad as shit. Also an Indian one sounds rad as shit, actually. I'm wondering if they get the French one is probably just going to be more anime cause it's France. Shane. What if they get the Arcane people to do a vision sort for this? Because it's France.
Oh.
You'll have to watch Star Wars now.
God damn it.
I've been telling you ever since Visions came out that you at least have to watch Visions because it literally has like a lot of your favorite people involved in it.
It's just anime, I know.
It's like fucking so I'm gonna strap Shane down and be like, do it! Just
strap me to a chair or a Clockwork Orange style and just fucking kidnap
Visions
me.
Takes
James Wan, who is the senior vice president for franchise content and strategy at Lucasfilm, asked the audience members if they were interested in more Star Wars anime such as Star Wars Visions, which basically means yeah, they're probably working on an actual full length Star Wars anime at some point. It's going to happen. Whether or not, I don't know what it's going to be. I remember reading somewhere that the rumor is that they are doing a, Star Wars anime, but it's an adaptation of something that already exists, which would be the most boring thing imaginable, frankly. It would be cool to see. You know what else is cool to see? Music. Specifically, Sound Euphonium.
Oh, here
we go. Because this dropped, I believe, like last night. This dropped pretty late yesterday. And I lost my shit. So let's read on. The Hibike Euphonium, Six Kame Daiyo Yuji de Omatsuri Festival. Jesus Christ, Kyoani.
Fucking God.
Event announced on Saturday that Kyoto Animation's new Sound Euphonium anime about Kumiko's third year in high school will air in 2024. In addition, the ensemble concert arc will get a medium-length anime, longer than a short, shorter than a feature, next year. The anime for the ensemble concert arc will have both a Blu-ray disc release and theatrical screenings. In the in-story band, as represented by the franchise's real-life progressive wind orchestra, theme life artist True and the K is cast in stage readings, is performing summer concerts on August 13th and 14th at Tokyo Lion Cube Shibuya. It's about time we got news on this, because this was announced so long ago.
This was announced, years ago.
This was, 2019 these were announced, that the third season wasn't, that the new project was announced. I'm happy it's a full season. I'm happy it's a full third season of this, which also means it is the first third season that Studio that KyoAni is producing by themselves. I say by themselves because they have done a third season before. It was free, but that's a collab with Animation Do. So that doesn't count. Sound Euphonium is the first third season that they're doing by themselves, and I'm really excited for it. I'm excited for the Medium Lands project that they're doing, because that's adapting the ensemble concert stuff, which I've read a little bit into it, just wondering, what the fuck does that mean? Apparently, it's... Okay, Spencer, have you seen the Sound UFO movie? Because...
No.
Fuck. Okay.
Unfortunate.
Fuck. All right. Shane, it's a thing about the... It's going to explain the post-credits scene. About how that
gotcha. Happened.
We're gonna see that. We're gonna finally see that come to fruition. Apparently, that's what it's about. Which I'm very excited for. I'm very excited for more of this. Our final piece of news is about Dragon Ball, because of course it is.
Fuck yeah.
So a theater poster for Dragon Ball Super Superhero. God, I fucking hate that.
Hate
name,
that title.
Is listing that the anime film will open in U.S. theaters on August 19th. Twitter user Trick the Trademark. I apologize, Trick the Trademark. If I'm butchering your Twitter handle.
Cool handle. In fact,
cool ass handle though. Is posted a picture of the poster on Saturday. It was displayed on the AMC Nishami 24 Theater in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, located within the Nishami Mall. And the photo is there. And apparently, now the photo has since been deleted off of Twitter. And apparently the poster has been removed. So from what the sound of it is that someone at the theater screwed up.
Someone was fucked up and is getting fired.
Someone's getting fired. And ANN did reach out to Crunchyroll, but the company stated it could not confirm the release date at this time.
Which means it's real.
Which means that this is the release date. We just can't say anything because we have NDAs and we can't break them.
Yeah, we are under contract.
But I'm very excited for this. August 19th is really soon, actually. But it's a little bit, it's not as soon as Broly.
Yeah.
Honestly, I think my guess is then maybe it took longer to dub because it's a CG film.
Because of the CG, probably, yeah.
Yeah. But I'm very excited for it. Will it be the best Dragon Ball film? Honestly, actually, maybe, because there's a lot of stuff about the story that really is really impressing me right now.
We'll see.
I'm very excited for it. I think this is the more I see of it, the more I'm just like, hell yeah, you know? Like, this Same. Feels right. Like, this looks really good.
I've had such a love-hate relationship with this movie, because up until, like, the last couple weeks, they've been really keeping those cards close to the chest. They have been showing nothing. And then the last week, they've shown a bunch, and I'm like, this is what I've wanted this entire marketing cycle.
Well, to be fair, that's just how Japanese marketing cycles work. We're getting, like, the movie's about to come out in Japan. The movie comes out in Japan on June 11th, which, as of recording is this week. It's on Saturday. So more than likely, that's why we're getting so much, is because we're in the week. You know how, like, we'll get, like, nothing for, like, a big film? Like, I'm using Marvel as an example. We get two trailers for, like, two main trailers for a Marvel film, nothing for months, and then the week leading to its release, there's, like, fucking 50 TV spots and half the movie spoiled.
Yep.
Because it's all on TV, and because there's this fucking, like, doubling down on the marketing efforts. That's what's happening here. That's exactly what's happening here. And they did confirm that Superhero, the poster also confirmed that it will be an exclusively movie theater release. No digital release for the time being. None of that in movie theaters and streaming at the same time bullshit. You want to see it? Go to the fucking theater.
Yeah, get your ass off the couch and go outside, you fool.
Yeah, so you want to see it? You want to see it? Go socialize with people.
Spend your money. Give to conglomerates.
Consume product, buy product to consume more product.
Consume product.
More product.
Write review and then for ask, product.
and then ask for more product.
Mm-hmm. Dragon Ball. So I think, and now we're pretty much done with moves, which means it's time to talk about our featured anime of the podcast, which is one of my favorite shows, favorite animes of all time, which is Mushishi, directed and written by Hiroshi Nakahama, from Studio Artland, and it ran initially from October 23rd, 2005 to June 19th, 2006, ran for 26 episodes, and is currently licensed by Funimation. I'm pretty sure that this first season, at least, is on Funimation's website.
It is wrong. Yes, it's sub and dub on Funimation. Season 2 mm-hmm. is on Crunchyroll.
Yeah, because it's licensed by that, because Season 2 is licensed by Aniplex of America. We are not talking about Season 2 here, because that would be way too much to cover. So we're just covering the first season. It is also and if you are planning to watch Mushishi, please note that only the first season of Mushishi is dubbed. The first season of Mushishi is infamously one of the biggest bombs in the English speaking anime community.
That show did not sell
well at all. Despite being very popular in certain niche circles with critics and also in Japan. Japan loves it. In any case, let's read on. Mushishi is set somewhere, in the period of Japan's history. They never exactly specify, but it's basically in between the Edo and Meiji periods. Japan's still closed, but there's like some 19th century shit in the country. Basically, it's sometime in the past. The story follows follows Ginko, who's someone known as a Mushishi, due to him having basically only one eye and having the ability, he can see various types of these creatures known as Mushi. Mushi are life forms that are ethereal and have weird supernatural powers. Not a lot of people know they exist. However, no one really knows a lot about them, other than they just exist in this world, and then sometimes people need to deal with them. Ginko employs himself as a Mushishi or Mushi master, and travels from place to place just researching these Mushi, trying to learn more about them, and aiding people who may be just involved because of problems involved with them, because they are creatures. So sometimes they do cause problems for people. And that's just kind of the show. Mushishi is a very interesting structure for episodes, in that there's no overarching story here. It's mostly just kind of like... It's almost like an anthology series where each episode focuses on a new Mushi or a new person or a new character, and Ginko just happens to be involved, sometimes in a big capacity, sometimes in a small capacity. He solves the problem and then fucks off. But the real treat of the show is always just everything around Ginko, less so him himself. Shane had not seen Mushishi going in, but I've been singing its praises for years, going in for a while. Shane, what did you think of Mushishi, especially after me singing its praises for like so long?
I really liked Mushishi. It's definitely one of the most interesting shows I think I've watched in quite some time. Because the only way I can really describe the experience of watching Mushishi is, like, imagine you're taking a leisurely stroll, a hike through a forest, and you're taking in the scenery, the nature, you feel, like, tranquility, you feel at peace. And then you happen to trip and fall down a fucking cliff. You're not hurt, but it was kind of a hindrance. But then you get back up and you just keep on going. And that's kind of what happens in Mushishi. It's just Ginko going from place to place, dealing with all of these different Mushi, meeting a bunch of different people who have issues involving Mushi. Some sort of conflict happens. And then by the end of the episode, everything is mostly resolved, some more circumstances, more so than others. And then he's just on his way. And it's like, it's so relaxing. It's so atmospheric. It's just a vibe show. I think, honestly, that's the best way I can describe Mushishi. It is 100% a vibe show. You just put it on, and you just vibe with it, you know?
Yeah, the Mushishi is a vibe show because it refuses to go at the pace. When you watch Mushishi, you have to go at its pace. It forces you to vibe along with its own pace.
You have to put yourself in the mindset of a fucking snail to tolerate Mushishi. Because if you expect any more or any less, you're not gonna vibe with it. It's just not gonna work for you.
Yeah. Spencer had seen Mushishi going into this podcast because I basically sat him down and said, "Watch this." Yes. And he watched it.
That was back when Matt said watch an anime. I went, "Oh, okay."
Yeah.
Put it on the list.
Yeah, put it on the list. But Spencer, what do you think? What do you think of Mushishi?
Mushishi is like the ultimate sleep aid. You know, Mushishi is melancholic. It's not necessarily sad, although it is sad. It's more just demure. I told him I'd credit this, so this goes to our friend Adam. It's like when you're driving behind somebody, like a grandma, and she's driving below the speed limit, and it should be aggravating, but you have some, like, really relaxing music, so you know what? You're just going for a drive. You're just relaxed, and
you're just vibing.
You're just vibing. With that being said, this show is unbingeable.
The most unbingeable show ever made, like, easily.
Cannot binge this show. Because it will just drain you.
If you binge this show, that is a one-way gate town to one, hating this show, but also falling asleep at episode like 4.
I made the mistake of watching 7 episodes in one day.
Why did you do that? We warned you against it.
It was just how it ended up. I just, okay. That's just how it ended up. And you know what? It didn't affect my outlook on the show. It didn't affect my opinion. But yes, don't binge this show. It's just, don't do it.
Back when I watched it, I was watching this and the beginning of Bleach at the same time.
I'm going to say, if you're going to binge this show, at least watch it with something else. Like, have a complimentary show.
Of like an something action show more, or something like actually bingeable.
A bit more energy, yeah.
Yeah, like fucking watch it with the new season of Stranger Things. Like each episode, that's like fucking 90 minutes, so gotta have something in between episodes. I love Mushishi. This is a show that I put on. This is the first show, by the way, that I watched due to AnnieTube's recommendation. Because Arcada constantly cites this show as one of his favorites, and shout out to the boy Arcada, fellow Canadian man. I watched it because he constantly sung its praises, so I was like, fuck it, I'll watch it. And quickly found out that don't binge this. But I had also never seen something like this before when I watched it. I don't think I was really ready for it. But the more I watched it, the more I loved it. I felt really engaged by it in a way that I hadn't been before. It was like, I watched it when I was like 14, 15. So it was like my first experience with like something that was like really artsy. For anime wise, I think the artsiest thing I'd watched at that point was like Ava, but Ava's still pretty accessible compared to this.
Yeah, it at least has a faster pace.
Yeah, at least it has a faster pace. So I it wasn't that like I wasn't like unexperienced with like Archie's stuff. I had watched Archie's stuff up to this point. But like this was like the first time I was like, oh, like this is for adults.
This is a work of art.
Yeah, like this is a different kind of anime. But I loved it. I thought it was really unique and different. And the older I get and the more that I think about it and the more I rewatch certain episodes, my favorite episodes all the time, the better it gets, which I think is the best thing about it. I think it's one of those, it ages really well. I think that is one of the big things about it. So let's talk about favorite episode, which we might all have different answers because it's one of the, again, it's an anthology.
It's one of those shows.
Mm-hmm. One of those shows. So Shane, what's your favorite episode of the show?
My favorite episode is episode 7, Raindrops and Rainbows.
Oh, this one. I love this one.
Oh, yes.
I just really love this episode. And it is 100% because I'm biased towards rainbows because I fucking love rainbows. But the actual story of it, the fact that it deals with like a man who has become obsessed with this one thing because it was passed down from his father. Like, he inherited his father's obsession, and now he's just destined to always be chasing after this rainbow. It's just...
Mm-hmm.
I just love that kind of story, and the way that Ginkgo gets involved and literally helps him chase down a fucking rainbow.
I love the ending of it, too. I think the ending is really thought-provoking in this one. Honestly, like you watch it and you're just like, fuck, and you have to like sit back for like 20 minutes to think about it. You're like, damn, what?
Have an existential crisis, like, oh fuck, what am I doing with my life?
Exactly, like it's one of those fucking, it's just a that's a really good one, actually. Spencer, which one's your favorite
episode? My favorite is episode 25, Plentiful Sights, Woeful Sights, or Eye of Fortune, Eye of Misfortune. Which is about the blind girl.
Oh, this one.
Yeah, so this was... The show was already incredible to begin with, but this was the moment where I was like, oh. Fuck.
Oh.
The Mushi just are. They're not negative or positive. They are. And the Mushi can help people, but there is always a drawback. So for this case, the young girl, Amine, she was born blind, and then the Mushi basically give her sight, but then she starts to see what she shouldn't be able to see. And it basically just ends with, you know, her eyes falling out.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah.
And Ginkgo having to basically bury a bunch of Mushi and deal with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, pretty fucking much, which is it's rough. It's a rough episode. Yeah, there's a couple of rough episodes in this. My favorite episode is episode 12, One-Eyed Fish. And my favorite thing about this episode is the fact that when you watch it, okay, my favorite thing about this episode is that It's the entire time you watch and you're like, where's this? You're kind of like unsure exactly where this is going, and it's not until like the last 2 minutes that you realize, oh shit, this is Ginkgo's origin. It takes a hell of a show to basically keep that information from you. Like so well and so quick and only to like the last minute, and it explains a lot about Ginkgo as a person too. When you watch it, I like the resolution of it. I think it's again in Mushishi fashion, suitably bittersweet in a way, but leaning on the bitter end for this one this time around, and it's It's just a really great episode. It has also one of the more kind of fucked mushies in the show.
And it's like one of your earlier indicators
about how dangerous the mushi can be if you're not ready to deal with them.
So let's, okay.
The thing is about Mushishi is that I don't know if we can talk about characters with this because it's the kind of show. There's only one recurring character. So,
and even then, he doesn't show up sometimes.
He doesn't show up till the end of episodes sometimes. So what we're actually going to do is we're actually going to skip that entirely this time. Because it's impossible to talk about, and we're just going to spend time talking about Ginkgo as a lead, because I feel like that Ginkgo is a unique lead in the realm of anime. You don't normally get a lot of characters like him, where he's honestly not the lead of. He's the lead of the show in that, like, he's technically in every episode, and he's always there, and he is the audience surrogate in a way. He's the one the audience follows, but he's never the main character except for his origin episode. He is always an observer. He's always just there. He just shows up, fixes the problem, and leaves. For one, Chad move. Second, I think that makes him a unique protagonist in the realm of anime, because it means that you can it's almost like that the main character of Mushishi is like the world of Mushishi.
Well I was gonna say, going off of that, I honestly feel like the focus of Mushishi is about people, not about Ginkgo. Ginkgo is a part of that, in that, you know, he travels around the world, he meets a whole bunch of different people who deal with Mushi. But yeah, obviously, Ginkgo is never in that lead role. He's more so serves as like an anchor to... He's kind of like that icon for the show, just so people know, yeah, this is Mushishi because this guy is in it. But Mushishi is way more concerned about delving into the lives of the people who inhabit this world, and Ginkgo just so happens to be a part of that.
That's pretty much exactly what I was basically going for. And I like that sometimes the Ginkgo is literally just a deus ex machina. You're spending the entire episode with like a puppet with other characters, and then Ginkgo only shows up near the end, or like in like the last act, to solve the problem for them, and then leaves. It gives a sense, and it lets you breathe with the rest of the other characters in the thing too, because all the people he meets are like these really layered, three dimensional people. And it gives a layer of texture to the world otherwise, because this is a very world building heavy show. And I think on that end, let's talk about like going to specifics. I want to talk about the art of the show, because Wallpaper Central.
Yeah.
shout out to
Artland.
Studio Artland. Rest in peace.
Frame is a painting.
Every frame is a fucking painting here. Literally, watching this show is like you're basically watching somebody just fucking cream all over the goddamn like fucking animation paper, because there's just so much good shit here. Whenever the show like wants to do a wide shot, I'm just like, oh wow, like holy shit,
yeah,
like, oh wow,
like the environmental art in this show is honestly like another level. Like the amount of detail they cram into those backgrounds is absurd.
Yeah, like it's almost like hyper realistic at points. Actually, I think. It's really interesting. It's really interesting. And then it's contrasted with like the weird ethereal shit of the Mushi. Which, by the way, the show is not to say that the show is simply just an art feast and the animation isn't exactly impressive. The actual animation, character animation, is still actually very good.
Mm-hmm.
The animation of the show overall is very good. Particularly when it comes to the Mushi stuff. I think the Mushi is interesting because a lot of it's just particle effects. But it's very well done particle effects. I think the moment I point to for good animation is when, like, fucking he's dealing with the person, like early on when he's dealing with the girl's eye and has to open up the eye and the shit comes out of that eye.
Yeah, and it just, like, pours out of her, like, bleh.
Yeah, but it's just, but the animation in that sequence is incredible. Like, mm-hmm. It's really good. The art and animation in this is so good. It's so, so fucking good. Shane, is there anything you want to bring up in particular with Mushishi? Because I know that you may have other stuff you want to bring up for it.
Show's just vibes, dude. Like, this is one of the shows I will now point to as an example of atmospheric storytelling. Because the atmosphere in Mushishi is, frankly, incredible. It's like, it's so dense with melancholy, but it also has that distinct aura of like hope and brain fart.
You got this.
It's the perfect balance of like melancholy and hopefulness. Like, it has that optimistic air to it, which I love in shows like this. The Mushi are interesting because they're not necessarily antagonistic, but they can be based on the circumstance. Like, the Mushi are never inherently threatening, inherently like volatile. It's just, you know, sometimes wrong place, wrong time.
Which I like. I like the fact that like all the conflicts in this show aren't just like the Mushi bad. Like a lesser series would just make the Mushi just these like fucking like, oh, they're bad creatures. They're really not. They just exist, bro. They just exist. Sometimes, actually. You see it actually more, I believe, in next passages. There's sometimes Mushi can be beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
They're actually like having them around is a good thing.
Well, that's the thing, because Mushi are just by nature forces mm-hmm. of nature. So mm-hmm. they just exist and you got to deal with them.
Mm-hmm. And okay, there's people, and of course there's people who like Ginka who know how to deal with them. I love that. I think there's so much there with the Mushi. Like, I think the Mushi is just one of the best creations of the show, and each Mushi is like so fucking unique too.
Mm-hmm.
They spend half the show is basically Ginko trying to figure out what the fuck is the Mushi.
Half the show is just him trying to add them to his Pokédex.
Pretty. This is just Pokemon, but if Pokemon was, like, really fucked.
Yeah.
If
Pokemon taught kids about the real world.
It did. It taught kids about animal abuse.
Yeah, unfortunate.
Yeah. Spencer, is there anything in particular with Mushishi you want to bring up that you...
The OP?
Oh my god, it's fucking incredible.
Yes! I was gonna say... I was like, who's going to bring it up first? Because the OP to this show is so unique.
The Sore mm-hmm. Feet song.
The Sore Feet song.
The Sore Feet song. Which I don't think there's any, I don't think there's a OP like it outside of this.
No.
I don't. It's in complete English. It's like a fucking English, like, indie song, which is, like, choice.
It's an indie acoustic track. And it's like, oh, okay.
Yeah, and the OP is just, you know, it's vibes, because it's just, like, the slow images of, like, nature in the background.
Way to set the fucking mood for your show right off the bat.
Animation-wise, animation wise, it's nothing, you know, stellar, but
I think that's the point.
That's the point. It's a mood setter. It sets the mood. It sets the atmosphere, the tone, the feeling of Mushishi. And that's something that I really need to drill home, is that Mushishi is an experience. And there is no anime like Mushishi, period. This was a one-of-a-kind thing to happen, and I think it's because of the people that worked on it. And do you know what the director's doing next?
He's doing Uzumaki, which I'm
He's doing Uzumaki.
That's why I'm very excited for Uzumaki. Because the guy who directed this, his name is Hiroshi Nagahama, who is kind of an auteur in the realm of anime. He doesn't do a lot, but he is well known. But his stuff, he has done a total of four shows at this point. That's it. Four shows. He did this and all of Mushishi, specifically, like, all of it. He did Detroit Metal City for Studio 4C, which, if you remember...
God.
Yeah. the exact opposite of fucking Mushishi. He did Flowers of Evil. And he also did The Reflection, which is the show that he did with Stan Lee. Honestly, Reflection wasn't actually that great. I wasn't a big fan of it. It was kind of a mess, unfortunately. But he is something of an auteur in the realm of anime, because his style is very evident and you can see it everywhere in Mushishi, which is why I'm very excited for Uzumaki, because he's directing that and is going to have music by the composer of fucking Hereditary. So,
yeah.
Ooh. Oh, fuck.
No, fuck it. Fuck it. So, yeah. Yeah.
Alan Stetson is his name.
Yeah. Shane heard that. It was like, oh, boy. Oh, no.
Flashbacks. PTSD.
And it's from Studio Drive, too. So,
oh, fuck.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, but we're getting off topic. But yeah, Mushishi, like, the people working on this is really great. I also want to bring up the music for the show, which I think is really good in general. Fun fact, the music for the show is from the composer for the OG Naruto.
Oh, yeah. Toshio Masuda.
As well as Kami-sama Kiss, a.k.a. the show with the dead samurai in the elevator.
Oh, the dead samurai in the elevator.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That show again. Elevator, yeah.
That show again.
God, we need to finish that show one day.
Yeah, but we absolutely do. Now any negatives anyone wants to bring up?
Shane? No.
No net. Oh, okay. No negative. That's a good sign. No negatives. Spencer, any negatives for Mushishi?
It's not for everybody.
Yeah, that's not.
I actually agree with that.
That's not an issue,
but it's something to bring up.
But it's something to bring up. This is not a show for everybody. This, if you can't sit still for 20 minutes at a time, 25 minutes at a time, if you don't like auteur, melancholic, slow ass shows, you will hate this.
If you watch Roma and were bored to tears by it,
don't watch this.
Write this one off. Take it, fucking write it off. Do not bother with this. I'm sorry.
This is 100% and I think Matt said this before I started watching it. It's a show where nothing happens, but everything happens. And you know exactly what you're getting into once you hear that. You know damn well.
Yeah. And I'm someone who loves that kind of story. I'm someone who loves those kinds of movies and those anime and those kinds of shows that are very atmospheric driven and very low on story but heavy on vibes. But they're not for everybody. My only issue with the show is not even an issue with the show. It's an issue with how Funimation decided to market it. Because for one, the dub for this show is fucking fantastic. One of the best dubs of its era. I think it's one of the best dubs of, like, the late 2000s dubs. It's one of the best ones that Funimation ever did. Travis Willingham, I think, gives a career best performance in this. I think this is the best he's ever been in anime. He is phenomenal as Ginkgo because he's so different than his usual performance. He's very quiet. He's extremely quiet in this. He shows a lot of range as an actor here. And Travis Willingham has gone on record to say that Mushishi is one of his favorite shows that he's done. And you can tell because he gives it all here. And of course, because it has a massive cast of characters with like literally for 26 the different characters every episode. This has so many like fucking veteran alumni for Funi. Like it has like so many people in this at the time. So pretty much everyone who was at working at Funimation at the time worked on their show. That being said, they decided to market it as like a fucking horror show. Which why?
No.
Yes, there's some scary stuff that happens here that can be like kind of spooky. But it's not scary. It's not a horror show. It's not a horror show. It's just not. And of course it caused it to bomb. And because of that, the next season was never dubbed. There's no dub of the second season, even though I'd argue the second season absolutely shits on the first season in terms of quality, which should get you very excited for the second season. It's just a shame that this show never caught on in the West. It's just one of those shows that just never ever did well here, which is really, really, really sucks because it's so, so good. Let's go for final scores because I want to, you know, let's talk about it. Shane, what do you give Mushishi final score?
I take a 5 and I add a 5 and that makes a 10.
You're like giving it the full 10.
It's, man, just like looking back on it and discussing it with you guys just makes me appreciate it even more than I already did, because I totally fuck with these kind of artsy, auteurist, nothing happens vibe shows. So it's like my favorite thing ever, essentially. But it's just really well made, and it's one of those shows that needs to be seen to be believed. You need to watch this show if you're into anime or shows of this style. You need to watch this at least once, I feel.
Yeah, I fully agree. I think if you're a hardcore anime fan, who watches anime for like as like their main medium, I think you owe it to yourself to at least watch like an episode of Mushishi just to say you watched it, because it deserves that level of attention. Spencer, what do you give Mushishi?
Oh, I give it the easiest 10. And it's just, it's not for everybody, but by Jove, is it for me. And that's all that matters in my score.
Because it is Mushishi, if you remember from last year, is in my top 10. So I have to add, as a fan of this show, I have to give it the full 11 out of 10. I love this show. It is one of my all-time favorites. Probably will stay that way for like years and years to come. I can't just imagine leaving. And I'm so happy when people end up really loving it, because it's one of those shows that deserves more attention than it gets. The manga is also been published in English. It's also like been being re-released slowly on manga. It was out early in their 2000s, but now it's being re-released, which I'm really happy for. So if you can, go check out the original manga too, because the artwork in the original manga is so good. The manga is written by Yuki Ushibata, who actually won a fucking excellence prize for manga, which is only really given to like fucking the best of the best stuff So like she won a bunch of awards for this. That was Mushishi, which means it's time to move on to the random anime generator. If you don't know how this works, we rotate every podcast between a pick from me and Shane to the randomizer. Mushishi was my pick, so it's time to move on to the random anime generator. Everyone here has used the meta except me. I am still not going to use it. I know when I'm using it. It will not be now for a variety of reasons. So which means that we have another true randomizer. So Shane has plans. He wishes to get Dark Tournament.
I have...
Listen,
I don't have a meta, but I am going to try my damnedest to get Yu Yu Hakusho. I am shooting for the stars, baby.
We're gonna get something not any of us wanted because we're gonna all put in different shit. How we did it last time and see what the fuck we get. All right. So I'm just gonna put all TV ratings for ease. Yep. As for watch links, all legal outlets.
Yep.
Legal outlets. Yep.
All legal outlets for episode count. Okay. Episode count. What are we thinking?
I want something short.
Yeah. If Shane wants Yu Yu Hakusho, he's going to have to put it at 100+ because
100. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Cause Yu Yu Hakusho is 100+. It's like 114, bro. It's like over, it might be more than that. Like 100. It's 120.
I forgot that the randomizer expanded that. I thought it was still 25.
Nope, it is 100+, which means that you would have to put it at 100+.
Fuck.
So, do you want to risk it and put 100+? Because that will literally put so many fucking anime. If we put it like 2 to 100+ to get rid of movies.
Oh, Chaos Element, baby.
You know what? Fuck it. Spencer, do you want that or are you vetoing it? Do you not want that?
Well, I mean, I'm a host, so I can veto his veto.
Exactly.
And then I can veto the veto the veto.
So
basically Matt would get the final call on it.
As per usual, yeah.
As per usual. Whatever.
And Matt already agreed to it, so.
Yeah, we're doing 2 to 100+, mainly because okay. I think it would be very funny if we got One Piece.
I was thinking that in the back of my head.
I was thinking it would be extremely funny, but I don't think we're going to get it. I have a sneaking suspicion, like something, my gut's telling me we're not going to get it. If we do get it, fuck it. I guess we get it. Okay, score range, what are we thinking?
I don't.
7 to 10.
Yeah, sure. That works for me.
I want something relatively good, but great. 7 to 10.
7 to 10? Okay. 7 to 10. You know what? Good shit. Year range, what are we thinking?
I request that the first be 1992.
1992? Okay. All right. At the minimum, it's not. Okay. So 1992. Spencer can make it go down more if he so desires, but it's the minimum, the lowest. At maximum, the lowest needs to be 1992.
Okay.
Do you want to leave it there, or
so? I don't care how far it goes, as long as the minimum is 92.
Yeah.
You know what? Then fuck it.
1989. Okay. Well, that's not that bad, actually. And then to what year? To now? To
2015.
You know what? For memes, we're gonna put it at like 2018.
2018 sounds good.
A compromise?
Yeah. Oh.
2017.
Yeah, you know what? 2017. Yeah. 2017. So all any anime that aired before we started the podcast. Pretty fucking much. Okay, included genres. I'll have Shane go first because I know what genres he probably wants for this.
We each get three, yeah.
Yeah, we all get three included, two excluded.
Okay.
I'd say. Mm-hmm. Unless you want less than more, depending.
I'm going
to
go with my...
You know what? Actually, I'll lower it to one excluded, because two excluded can make... Yeah.
Okay. My included, I'm going to go action, shonen, okay. Supernatural.
Okay. Action, shonen, supernatural. Okay. Spencer.
Mm-hmm.
What do you want? What three? Actually, Shane, what excluded do you want?
Oh, edgy.
Okay. Spencer, which included do you want?
Comedy.
Okay.
Adventure.
Okay.
And
he's thinking.
We'll say sport.
Okay.
Sports. Okay, early sports month.
Premature sports show.
Also included genre. Excluded. Which one is it?
Oh, harem.
Thank you.
All right. Mm-hmm. For included, my included is going to be fantasy. We're going to put in, we're going to put fantasy. We're going to put in drama. And fuck it. Let's put in magic. Let's see what we get with that. And then exclude isekai. I love how our three excluded are just the ones that were just like, yeah, no thanks.
No thanks.
Every time they're gone.
I'm good, buddy.
All right. All TV ratings, all legal sites, 200 plus episodes, 7 to 10 score range, use range is 1989 to 2017. Included genres include action, shonen, supernatural, comedy, sports, adventure, drama, fantasy, and magic, with excluded genres being ecchi, harem, isekai.
Crossing my fingers.
All right, I am generating the anime now.
Here we go.
Yo!
It's not Hakusho.
I don't know if we can cover it. I don't know if we can cover this, though, because I don't know if it's based into seasons.
What is it?
Well, let me check. What is it?
The answer is, yes, we can. The first season is 26 episodes. Okay, next time on the podcast, we are covering the first 26 episodes of, the first 26 episodes of first season of D. Greyman.
Oh, shit.
I've heard of D. Greyman.
A show I've been wanting to watch for fucking years.
Not mad. Not mad.
No, I am not mad. Losing a loved one is so painful that one may sometimes wish to be able to resurrect them, a weakness that the enigmatic Millennium Earl exploits. To make his mechanical weapons, known as Akuma, he uses the souls of the dead that are called back. Once a soul is placed in an Akuma, it is trapped forever, and the only way to save them is to exorcise them from their vessel using the anti-Akuma weapon, Innocence. After spending 3 years as the disciple of General Cross, Alan Walker is sent to the Black Order, an organization comprised of those willing to fight Akuma and the Millennium Earl to become an official exorcist. With an arm as his innocence and a cursed eye that can see the suffering souls within an Akuma, it's up to Alan and his fellow exorcists to stop the Millennium Earl's ultimate plot, one that can lead to destruction of the world. This is it. No, D. Greyman is widely regarded as a seminal shonen classic, modern classic of shonen. And I am very excited to watch it because I have not seen it. It has been on my watch list for a very, very, very long time. I have had multiple people come out to say that it is their favorite shonen. It is a constant like top fiver for some people. So I am extremely excited to check this out. Next time we'll be watching the first season or the first 26 episodes of D. Greyman. I'm Matt, aka Legion Rex. You can find me on Twitter at Legion Rex, as well as on YouTube at Legion Rex with me and my co Shane, aka the Bearded One. You can find him on Twitter at Bearded Gaming Network, as well as on YouTube on the same name, where he posts podcasts, let's plays, unboxings, gameplay videos, and numerous other stuff. You can also find him on Twitch at Bearded Gaming Network, where he streams every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, unless he takes a break. And you can go watch him there at 7 p.m. usually on those days where he streams until around 10. And he will be possibly finishing Yakuza 5 this week.
I'm probably, the day this goes up, I'm probably finishing Yakuza 5 tonight. So yeah. Please come watch.
You might need two streams. Possibly. I say possibly. It depends on how fast you go.
Well, I know you don't. I know two chapters.
Yeah, I know you don't want to rush it, but I also know that you're on a time limit.
I don't really care, but I spent the last 3 months with Yakuza 5, so you know.
Yeah. But yeah, pretty much. But in any case, with me, I also have my co-host Spencer. You can find him on Twitter at BeeryBert with two E's. Where he likes a lot of cosplay pictures and is currently the official Twitter account for the fan club for the Cincinnati Bengals, the fan account for
the and the Toronto Blue Jays.
Yep, that them too. I hope you all enjoyed this podcast, and we'll see you all next time for the first season of D. Gray Man.
That's gonna be interesting.
Yeah, it's gonna be a blast. That's what it's gonna be.
I'm fucking excited. Anyway, see y'all later.
Thank you for listening to The Gap. If you like what you've seen, you can subscribe to The Gap Podcast YouTube channel to get the latest podcasts as they go live. Be sure to like and comment and let us know what you guys think of the show. Thank you very much for tuning in, and we'll see you next week. Don't get that goal.